Good evening, and welcome to TTNT, Truthful Transformation Thursday. Thank you for joining us. The music that you hear during the time that we are together tonight, we do not own any of the rights to any of the music that you will hear during our time together tonight. We appreciate those who are gifted and those who don't mind sharing their gift with the world, those who are vocalists and musicians, and God has gifted them to be a gift to the kingdom, and we appreciate them so very much. So we are live tonight from the sanctuary of the Beargrass Missionary Baptist Church, 2300 Payne Street, Louisville, Kentucky. Tag your friends. Let somebody know that TTNT, Truthful Transformation Thursday, is live, and we're here to see if we can't become better disciples. We are lifelong learners as a disciple, and we just want to see if we can do that better. So while we take a few moments and give some others time to get on, thank you so very, very much for being with us. As always, I certainly thank my co-laborer in this TTNT ministry, Sister Christine. Thank you so much. And we appreciate you. You are a tremendous blessing to the kingdom. And we thank you for all that you do. Donnie McClurkin, in his rendition of Stand. We'll give some folk a few more moments to get on. Come on and join us. If you're joining us tonight, wave at us, let us know you're on with us. We'd appreciate it. Thank you so much. Thank you, Minister Nantine. Thank you so much. Good evening to you as well. Please know again, we do not own any of the rights to any of the music that you will be hearing during our time together tonight. Let a friend know, tag somebody, touch somebody. Let's study and learn together. As we're waiting for others to join us, go ahead and get your Bible, get your pencil, get your paper. We're walking our way through Mark's Gospel, chapter 5. We're going to begin tonight at verse 21. Read down through the end of the chapter. That's Mark's Gospel, chapter 5, beginning at verse 21. All right, that was the Reverend Dr. Donnie McClurk and Stan. Thank you again for being with us tonight. We appreciate all of you that are joining us wherever you are, wherever you might be. Thank you for taking the time to spend a few moments with us tonight on Truthful Transformation Thursday, where we attempt each and every Thursday night to learn how to be a better disciple. Disciples mean that you are a constant and lifelong learner, and we're always trying to learn that we might be better, that we might do better, that we might be a sweet-smelling savor in the nostrils of our God as we learn His Word and learn more about Him. The more we learn about God, the closer we will walk with God. The more we learn about God, the more that we will understand His goodness and His mercy. The more we learn about God, the more we will be able to meet the assignment that God has laid before us, and that we will do what the Lord has planned and purposed in our lives to do. And so before we get into the lesson again, we're going to try to finish out, if we can, Mark chapter 5 tonight, beginning at verse 21 and reading down through to the end of chapter 5. But before we do, let me continue to say that we are praying for the family of our own Reverend David Dow, Warren David Dow. Amen. He transitioned this past Monday, and the arrangements are this, not tonight, a week from tonight, next Thursday, I believe that's the 12th, next Thursday, here at the Beargrass Missionary Baptist Church. We will have his wake here from 5 to 8, 5 to 8:30 on next Thursday here at the church. And then his celebration of life will be here at Beargrass Friday. We will have a viewing from 9 a.m. to 11, and then we will have the celebration of life right at 11 a.m. on next Friday. So let's keep the Dow family lifted in our prayers. We want them to know that we are with you. Amen. We're trying to as well walk with you during your time of bereavement. Reverend Dow meant a lot to our church, and he meant a lot to so many people. He has stamped his influence, and he has demonstrated his love to so many people down through the years. And we just want you to know that we are praying with you, and we are praying for you at this time. Also, we want to pray for the family of Pastor Robert Lyons, who was the pastor of the Lambton Baptist Church here in our city. His visitation will be Monday night, I believe, or around 5 to 8 at the Lambton Baptist Church. And then his celebration life will be Tuesday at the Potter's House of the Cable Missionary Baptist Church at 11 a.m. on this coming Tuesday. This coming Tuesday at the Cable Baptist Church's Potter's House, Reverend Dr. Anthony Middleton serves as the illustrious pastor there at Cable. Let's pray for the wife and the family of Reverend Robert Lyons, and for the church family of the Lambton Baptist Church. All right. Let us open with a word of prayer. God, we love you so much. We appreciate this time that you have preordained for us to be together. We pray, God, that you will illuminate our minds and allow your word to find lodging places in our hearts. We pray, God, that you would permit us to dig for the jewels and nuggets that comes from your word, that we might raise our level of commitment because of it, that we might, God, have a deeper and better understanding of your word, which in turn will be a blessing to our lives, and that will hold us up in the ministries that you have put before us. God, I ask you, bless again this time that we have together. Bless everyone that will join us tonight and everyone that will see this streaming in days to come. We ask, God, that someone will be blessed from these efforts tonight. Someone will be helped from these efforts tonight. And someone, God, will be delivered from these efforts tonight. We love you, God, and we pray your presence right now in the midst of our study and our time together. In the name of Jesus, we ask all of these blessings. Amen. All right, we're going to, if you already got your Bibles, and we're going to jump in Mark chapter 5, beginning at verse number 21. I'm going to read it through again. I know we read it last week, but it does not hurt to read the Word of God often and over again. The more we read it, the more we will be able to pick and pluck the jewels and nuggets that are beneficial to our betterment. Each time I read it, I normally see something that I didn't see the time before I read it. And then when I think I have exhausted my reading ability, I ask God to show me something that I missed. And he will do that for us, because the Word of God cannot be exhausted. There's no exhaustion to the Word of God. And so we ask God to continue to pour out his blessings upon us as we learn of him and as we dive into his Word and as we become better children of God. So let us read beginning at verse number 21, Mark's Gospel, verse number 21. I will be reading from the New King James Bible, version of the Bible. If you have a different version, the words might be slightly different, but the meaning and the message is the same. Mark's Gospel, chapter 5, verse 21, we find these words. Now, when Jesus had crossed over again by boat to the other side, a great multitude gathered to him, and he was by the sea. And behold, one of the rulers of the synagogue came, Jairus by name. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet and begged him earnestly, saying, "My little daughter lies at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her that she may be healed, and she will live." So Jesus went with him, and a great multitude followed him and thronged him. Now, a certain woman had a flow of blood for 12 years and had suffered many things from many physicians. She had spent all that she had and was no better, but rather grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came behind him in the crowd and touched his garment. For she said, "If only I may touch his clothes, I shall be made well." Immediately the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of the affliction. And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that power had gone out of him, turned around in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" But his disciples said to him, "You see the multitude thronging you, and you say, 'Who touched me?'" And he looked around to see her who had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell down before him and told him the whole truth. And he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your affliction." While he was still speaking, some came from the ruler of the synagogue's house, who said, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" As soon as Jesus heard the words that were spoken, he said to the ruler of the synagogue, "Do not be afraid, only believe." And he permitted no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. Then he came to the house of the ruler of the synagogue and saw a tumult and those who wept and wailed loudly. when he came in, he said to them, why make this commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping. And they ridiculed him. But when he had put them all outside, he took the father and the mother of the child and those who were with him and entered where the child was laying. Then he took the child by the hand and said to her, Talitha kumma, which is translated, little girl, I say to you, arise. Immediately the girl arose and walked, for she was 12 years of age. And they were overcome with great amazement, but he commanded them strictly that no one should know it, and said that something should be given her to eat. That is the last verses of the fifth chapter of Mark. And someone is knocking on the door and they don't know that we are having TT&T. And so I'm not gonna stop our lesson to go to the door and see them. And so they're gonna have to kind of wait. I know we got some folk coming in later on. So excuse me for the knock, but we will go forward with all of our lesson tonight. But it seems like they're gonna keep on knocking. And so what I'm gonna do is I'm going to let them in while you listen a little more to a few of the words coming from our music. Give me 1 second, and I'm going to be right back. All right, it is one of our wonderful members that has forgotten that I was online, and we appreciate them coming and showing up for TT&T. All right, now let me get back to where we were. So in this fifth chapter of Mark, there's a couple of things that I want to bring out to us. For first and foremost, let me just give you a refresh, if you will, of the fifth chapter of Mark. There's three major things that kind of takes place here in this chapter. One, we see in the fifth chapter of Mark, the healing of a demon-possessed man. We covered that man that Jesus healed on the other side of the lake, and then he had to get back in the boat and come to where he is now, as we see him in our text and scripture for today. And then secondly, the healing of the woman with the flow of blood. That's verses 25 through 34. And then lastly, the raising of Jairus' daughter. That's verses 21 through 43. So what we need to understand is that Mark chapter 5 actually showcases Jesus' authority and power over demons or over diseases and over death. And those are three major components that you and I deal with, and so does everybody as those who walk on these mundane shores. Those are three major things that as humans we have to deal with, as people that we deal with. We deal with dealing with demons, and there are folk who are demon possessed. We deal with diseases and sicknesses and need healing. And as well, some of us have even been to the point of death and called on the Lord, and he brought us back to health. And so those are three major things that the fifth chapter of Mark deals with. So let's kind of look at what's going on here that would be beneficial to our betterment, that will bless our lives, that you and I can take a hold of and see if we can gain some wisdom and some knowledge from. The first thing that I want to point out is that when Jesus went to the other side, obviously people knew who he was and knew his capability and knew that to be amongst Jesus gave you a great opportunity to receive the blessing that you needed in order for your life to get better, in order for you to be better and do better. And so people really want it. I think it suggests that people really want to do better. They don't want a life that is toe up from the flow up. They don't want a life that has no purpose, or it seems like that each and every day of their lives that they actually wind up suffering behind life itself as life starts lifing and it seems like they can't get a break nowhere. I don't know of anybody who wakes up in the morning and says, hey, I want my life to be miserable today. I don't want to accomplish anything today. I don't want to be a benefactor or a benefit in any way or anywhere today. No, we get up each and every day hoping and praying that we will be a blessing to someone, that we might be a ray of sunshine, if you will, to somebody's life. We want to get up and know that our life means something, that we have purpose. And in order to do that, I'm simply saying you have to have Jesus in order for that to be genuine and in order for that to happen. And so I think we need to see that in this text. People knew and understood, obviously, the word that got out about Christ and how he was helping people, healing people, delivering people, and blessing people. And so everywhere he went, everywhere his presence was, people wanted to be around him. And so in this case as well, when he got to the other side, there was a multitude that gathered around him. And Mark says, behold, there was one who came, who was the ruler of the synagogue, who was named Jairus. Now, Jairus, obviously, again, has heard about Jesus. So let me pause parenthetically right there and say, who is hearing about Jesus through my life and through your life? Who is hearing about the saving power, the delivering power, the loving power of Jesus in your life and in my life? Are we living a life to where somebody, again, I think I said this on last week, where somebody is saying, I see something in you that causes me to believe that you are a child of God, that you are a Christian, that you have a God on your side, and that God is the one and only God, the Yahweh, that you are a disciple of Jesus Christ. I see it in you. I don't know about you, but there's been many of times in my pilgrimage, in my journey, where I was walking, did not know a person, did not know that that person even existed in the world, but because our path crossed, they would say to me, you're a preacher. And I say, yes, I am. And how did you know that? Well, I can look at you and tell. So I think the question is, can someone look at you and tell that you are a child of God? People wanted to be where Jesus was. I think that's another issue. Are we presenting our love for Christ in such a way that people want to be where Jesus is? Is the presence of the Lord so powerful in our lives, in our churches, in our worship experiences, that people want to be there? These people wanted to be around Christ. Now, when Jairus came to Christ, he came obviously because he believed that if he could get to Jesus, Jesus could then heal his daughter who was at home, who was sick to the point of death. And because he had this belief, then he was willing to go where Jesus was. And I think that you and I also have to look at how many people who need delivering would know that they can come to the church where we serve, the church that we claim to be ours and really know that what they need in their life, they can find there. Can they find Christ at our places of worship? Can they find the true and living God at the churches where we serve? Or have we closed our doors to such a point that where people will walk past and never think that I can walk into this particular building during a Sunday morning worship and find the deliverance in Christ that I need? Or do they come in and look around and say, these folk aren't any different than the folk that I'm walking out here in the world with, so there's no sense in me spending or wasting my time. And so I think it's important for you and I to really look at how we present ourselves, because how we present ourselves, if God the Holy Spirit is in us, that's how we also present God the Holy Spirit. That's how we also present God the Son of God. That's how we also present God the Father. So the question becomes then, how am I presenting God through the life that I am living? How am I presenting God through the way I walk and the way I talk and the way I think and the deeds that I attempt to do for others? How am I presenting God? Is anybody seeing God in me? I think that that is a legitimate question as a disciple of Christ that we ought to ask ourselves, because when Jesus was around, people thronged him. They crowded around him. They wanted to be a part of whatever he was doing. I forgot the songwriter who said, I think it's Paul Martin, who says, Lord, whatever you're doing in this season, please don't do it without me. And so that says a lot. That speaks volumes when we tell God that whatever he's doing, however he's blessing, however he's manifesting, please don't do it without me. I want to be a part of what you're doing, God. I want you to use me to be a blessing to somebody else. And so Jairus, the synagogue ruler, had to have heard something good about Jesus. He had to have heard something that convinced him that it was worth his time. It was worth the trip that he had to make, however far he had to go to get to Jesus for this request. Now, I think you also got to look at this and see what we pulled out of it, because it wasn't Jairus who was going to Jesus asking for something for himself, but he was going to Jesus asking for something for his daughter. And he had confidence. You can listen to how the language flows and see that Jairus had confidence. Now, we pointed out last week that when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet and begged him earnestly, saying, my little daughter lies at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her that she may be healed and she will live. And so the first thing he did, I point out this week, is worship. And so I think that we have to look at how authentic is our worship. When we come on Sunday mornings, when we come on Wednesday nights, or whatever night that we are at our churches, how authentic is our worship? Because I think if we're going to ask Christ to bless us in major and mighty ways, our worship ought to be authentic. And I wonder how many of us must ask the questions, I'm hoping and I'm praying that you are satisfied with my praise. I hope that you're satisfied with my worship. And if not, what is it that you must do in your own mind, in your own thoughts, that would make your worship authentic? Or are you just checking the boxes? Are you just showing up out of habit? Are you just coming to church because that's what you do on a Sunday, or that's what you do on a Wednesday or Thursday or Tuesday or Monday or whatever day you come to church? Are you just showing up so that you can say, I went to church? You walk in and then you walk out unchanged. You walk in and you walk out are undelivered. You walk in and you walk out with nothing more than you had when you walked in. It's not in a lot of cases that there's not anything there for you. A lot of cases is we refuse to eat the off the buffet that God has laid before us. And so if you are a genuine worshiper of God, then I think every opportunity that you get, then you ought to demonstrate that authentic worship that you have. So think about that, child of God, you know, and ask yourself that question. When I go, how genuine is my worship? Or am I more concerned about who's looking at me, or who's talking about me, or what other folk are thinking about me, or I have a beef with someone else, some other brother or sister in the church? What are you thinking about? What is your motive for coming? And how authentic is your worship when you come to the house of God? Not only when you come to the house of God, do you have your own private worship time with God? Are you actually taking time out each and every day to worship God and to be thankful unto God for all the manifold blessings that he's bestowed amongst you and upon you? Now, is it that your desire is that you want your worship to be so authentic that every day you feel the presence of God? Every day, God is at the forefront of your mind, and that you are demonstrating your appreciation for all that God is doing and has done in your life. And so Jairus had to hear something that convinced him that it was worth his time, energy, and effort to go find Jesus, to ask Jesus to come and lay hands on his daughter. And so he did. And obviously, when he came and he fell down before him and he worshiped him and he begged him earnestly, meaning that he was very sincere in his request. And I wonder sometimes, even when we pray, how sincere we are in our requests. Now, I think that there's a lot of times that we are sincere in our requests when we're sick and we want to be healed, but we're not so sincere in our requests when we're actually asking for forgiveness for some stuff that we really enjoy doing that we know we have no business doing. And so how sincere are we as we petition God for something that we want him to do in or about our lives? And so he begged him. He was sincere. He was earnest. He was serious about his request and told Christ directly what it was that he wanted. He didn't beat around the bush. He was specific in his request. And I think that there is benefits to us being specific in our requests. Just like we're specific if I got a physical ailment and I'm asking God to heal that ailment, and I'm specific, Lord, heal my stomach problem, heal my cancer problem, heal my heart problem, whatever my problem is. We're specific, but are we specific when we ask God for forgiveness of sins that so easily beset us? Are we as specific when we ask God, or do we throw them all in a bundle and say, God, please forgive me of all of my many sins and keep on moving? Maybe, just maybe, we ought to identify some of those sins that we really want God to deliver us from, so that God knows, he knows all things anyway, but he knows that we know that we're really sincere about wanting to be better and wanting to do better. And so he was specific in his request, and his belief was demonstrated in the language and the way that he asked God. He said to Christ, my little daughter lies at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her that she may be healed, and she will live. He had no doubt that if Jesus came and laid his hands on his daughter, then she will live. So he came with great anticipation that Christ had what he needed to deliver his daughter from her sickness, to deliver his daughter from her illness. And so he felt like that if Jesus will come, then ain't no ifs, ands, or buts about it. I'm not going to doubt the faith that I have displayed that God will hear, answer, and take care of my daughter. And so I believe that because of the genuineness of this request of Jairus, and because of the sincerity of the attitude that he brought to worship, and because he was specific in what he was asking Christ to do, Christ went with him. Because verse 24 says, Jesus went with him, and a great multitude followed him and thronged him. And so when Jesus moved, the crowd moved. So what does that say to you? It really kind of says that wherever Jesus is, if his presence is manifested, then the crowd is going to be where Jesus is. And if we're not having crowds when we think we should have crowds, could it be that maybe the presence of Jesus ain't quite there yet? Or maybe we haven't demonstrated our sincerity in worship, or we have not demonstrated our specific request that has caused the presence of the Lord to manifest himself. And so sometimes I wonder, even when I come to church and I'm all excited about what the Lord is getting ready to do, and the praise team or the choir really sings with power and conviction, and then all the folks sitting in the pews just look at them. They don't engage. They don't get involved. It's almost like that old, saying, well, it really don't take all of that. You can't tell me how to praise. And no, I can't tell you how to praise. But I can say to you that if you believe, you ought to show some sign. I can say to you, if God has done anything for you, you ought to be a witness. And I don't know of any silent witnesses that the Lord has. There's something about you witnessing to someone else through act and action that lets people know that you are appreciative of what the Lord has done for you. Now, here it is. On his way. He's on his way to answer the request and to lay hands on Jairus' daughter while he's traveling, while he's on the way. The Bible says a certain woman, and I'm glad that the writer didn't put a name here. The writer says a certain woman, so we can put our name there. A certain woman had a flow of blood for 12 years and had suffered many things from many physicians. She had spent all that she had and was no better, but rather grew worse. Now, here it is. She discovered that after I had done all that I know to do, and it still didn't work, maybe I ought to try Jesus. Because when she heard about Jesus, so if she heard about Jesus, that means somebody had to be talking about Jesus. If she heard about Jesus, that means that somebody had to be telling the story about Jesus and his love and his ability to deliver and to heal and to help and to cast out demons. She had to have heard something that allowed her, like Jairus, to say, if I can just get to Jesus, I'm convinced that I'm going to be all right. Now, one of the versions says that she said within herself. So she had made up in her mind that if I can just get to Jesus, I'm convinced that he can heal what nobody else could heal. And so sometimes, because I think some of you theologians out there would ask the question, well, why did God allow her to go 12 years and go to every doctor and spend all her money and still not get well? What kind of God is that? But just maybe, God permitted that to happen so that he could get the glory through her issue. Sometimes God will allow and permit things to happen in our lives so that he can get the glory for whatever the issue. Could nobody else claim that they had the power to heal this woman but Jesus, because she had already spent all her money on physicians. She had already went to many physicians and she did not get any better. As a matter of fact, the Bible says that she got worse. Sometimes God will permit us to have certain situations so that he can demonstrate to the world his power. And his power came in two forms, in two ways. One, his power came in the fact that she made up in her mind. And so her part was, if I can just get to Jesus. His part was, when he got touched, who touched me? I know that something specific happened. It wasn't just the people who were bumping up against me, as we said on last week. And so that's why I'm convinced that the disciples didn't understand what he was saying. When he says, who touched my clothes? And they said, how do you ask these questions? In other words, all these people gathered around and they thrown in you and you asked, who touched me? Jesus knew that there was a special touch. It wasn't a casual brush up against or a casual bump into, but somebody touched with intentionality. And so when we come to Jesus with intentionality for what is going on in our lives, I'm convinced that he pays special attention, because it's obvious to me that out of all of the people who are surrounding him and bumping up against him and touching him, the special touch, that touch of the woman who touched with intentionality, gathered and gained his attention. Why? Because when she touched him, what she needed left him and hit her. What she needed left him and hit her. And so when we realize that what we need, if we have the right attitude and if we have the right message, if we have the right situation to where we will approach Christ right, then we will receive what we have. So I said last week, I said again this week, Jesus was on his way to cure Jairus' daughter, to lay hands on her. On his way, the woman who had an issue of blood for 12 years knew that she could just touch him. She did. So he was on his way to bless someone else, and she got blessed along the way. That's a word for somebody. That's why you ought to show up for church every Sunday, because what you need, while he's blessing someone else, he's in the neighborhood, and he can very easily stop by your house. While he's blessing someone else, you can be blessed while he's on his way. It was not his intent when he got into the boat, got to the other side, got out of the boat, all these people around him. It was not his intent to bless this woman. It was his intent to fulfill the request of Jairus. But on his way, she understood. And so I say all the time, don't get upset with your neighbor. Don't get mad because other folk are being blessed, because if your neighbor gets blessed, that suggests that Jesus is in the neighborhood. And if Jesus is in the neighborhood, then there's a good chance that you can get blessed too. There's a good chance that he can stop by your door, your house, and give you what you need as well. And so she did. She acknowledged it was her who touched him, because, again, the custom of the day was she had this issue of blood. She was not supposed to be out amongst the people. She could get in serious trouble, because you're not supposed to be bleeding and be amongst the crowd, but she was willing to take that chance. And I want somebody to know tonight that when you're at that point, when life is life into that point, I don't care what nobody say, I know within my soul, if I can just get to Jesus, he will make everything all right. And so here it is. What she had to do is she had to get through the crowd. Now, I say that to say this, and that is, sometimes, child of God, disciple of Christ, you got to get through what's crowding you out from Christ. Get through the naysayers of of the place where you're going. Get through those who got a negative attitude that shows up every Sunday with a frown on their face. You got to get through the crowd, the thing, the people that's blocking you from your blessing. You got to ignore that, bump your way, elbow your way, push your way through so that you can receive the blessing that God has in store for you. She didn't mind taking that chance to get to Jesus. She did. She shared with him, and his response to her was, your faith, because you was determined. You understood if you could get to me, then you would be blessed. You would be healed. Your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your affliction. She knew she was healed the moment she touched him. She knew she was healed when she got to that point where she could reach her hand and touch the hem of his garment. And sometimes for some of us, child of God, all we need to do is just get to Jesus and don't let anything or anybody stop us or deter us. And so he did. She did. He sent her on. He's still on his way to Jairus' daughters to heal her. He gets there. And the Bible says that there is a lot of commotion going on. And Jesus makes that known. Why are y'all raising all of this commotion? There were at that time, and I want to back up and catch another point, but there were at that time what they called professional mourners. They were paid to come to where they thought someone had died, and they were paid to be mourners and mourn and weep and wail and holler and cry. I don't know necessarily what all of that was about, but that was a tradition. But let me back up and catch this before I got too far ahead of myself. When he was on his way, after the woman had gotten healed, people from Jairus' house came to him and said to him that your daughter is dead. So ain't no sense. Why trouble the teacher any further? Don't trouble the teacher because it's a waste of time. Your daughter's dead. Sorry about the fact that your daughter is dead. But when Jesus overheard that, what he said was, do not be afraid. Because what grips and grabs us most of the time is fear. We fear causes us to go into a horrific mode of horror because we think that the worst is the worst and the end is the end. And so Jesus says, do not be afraid. It's interesting to me that in many cases in dealing with the people, Jesus would have to say, do not be afraid. When they're faced with trauma and drama, Jesus would say, do not be afraid. When they're in the midst of the storm and he's right there to heal them, he has to first tell them, do not be afraid. It seems like when there was ever any major calamity that happened, the first thing that Jesus had to say before he performed whatever miracle, before he did whatever deliverance, whatever healing, he would have to say to those around, those who were concerned, do not be afraid, only believe. And so he said, replace your fear with your faith. Replace your fear with your faith. And so he says, and he permitted no one to follow him. So now he had to get rid of the crowd because you got a bunch of naysayers. He gets to the house and they got all this commotion going on. And he asked in verse 39, why make this commotion and weep? The child is not dead, excuse me, but sleeping. And so he makes the determination of what's going on in the situation. In other words, y'all think she's dead. I'm letting you know that she's not. She's asleep. And so they laughed at him. The New King James Version said they ridiculed him. Other verses said they laughed at him. They scorned him. They thought he was funny. They thought he was a joke. They thought that he was a prankster. In their mind, they felt obviously that this child is dead and we're here and we're mourning. And Jesus says she's not dead, she's sleeping. And so they start laughing as if you don't know what you're talking about. But here's the problem. It wasn't that he didn't know what he was talking about. What it was that they didn't know who he was. Because Jesus can turn your midnight immediately into midday. He can turn your cancer into cancer free. And so he put them out. He wouldn't let them come in to the house. He took the wolves that was with him, Peter, James, and John, and he took the father and the mother of this 12-year-old girl who was sick and ill and at the point of death. And so here's the other point that I think is important. If my time has ran out, I should have been through 5 minutes ago, but here's the point that I think is important. Sometimes you got to put some people out of your life in order to get some stuff done. Sometimes you got people who are stirring up all kind of commotion over what is not true, and you got to put them out before you can get anything done. Now, I know that was the custom of the day, and I know that that sound good, and that's what they did, but sometimes you got to put some folk out of your entire life if you want God to bless you in the way that you need to be blessed. And so he goes in with Peter, James, and John, the mother and father of the child. He went to where she was laying, and Mark says, she says, Talitha Kumma, which is translated, little girl, I say to you, arise. And when he spoke to her, she immediately got up, Mark says, and she walked because she was 12. That's what young folk do. She was a young person. Her energy was there if she walked. Her limbs were operating if she walked. And obviously, she wasn't dead if she got up and walked. And so she walked, and he said, don't y'all tell nobody, because they ain't going to believe it no way. This is a blessing that I want you to hold to yourself. So go ahead and get her something to eat. That brings us to the end of chapter 5. What a marvelous way of demonstrating the power of God, as well as letting us know some jewels and nuggets. And so let me backtrack real quick. First and foremost, there is no problem that Jesus can't solve. There is no issue that Jesus can't take care of. Sometimes you just got to get some folk out of the way so that Jesus could get in. They were making a commotion. They were all around the house. They were blocking the door. They were weeping and wailing and crying and hollering and screaming. And Jesus would not allow them to come in, as he did not want that negative energy around what he was about to do, what he was getting ready to do. So I say to us, sometimes you got to just put some folk out the way and don't care about them or what they're doing or the commotion that they're stirring up, and go ahead and allow Jesus to enter into your life. I secondly say, as I backtrack, that when Jesus is on his way, don't ridicule your neighbor because they're being blessed and you're looking at your situation and you're saying, well, I don't know why they're being blessed and I'm not, because what will happen is that if Jesus is in the neighborhood, he'll bless you as well. And so don't, whatever you do, take that for granted that you won't get no blessing. You go where Jesus is, and I promise you, if you approach him with sincerity, with a made up mind, and with your faith, knowing that he's able to do whatever you need for him to do, then God is going to bless your life. And so I think my time is up. I'm actually over it. So thank you, my brothers and my sisters, for joining us tonight. We appreciate all that you do. And we want you to know that God loves you, and so do we. And love is an action word, and ain't nothing you can do about it. But reread chapter 5 and then see what jewels and nuggets that you can pick out of this lesson that has come our way today. So again, we just want to mention, if you would be so kind, to keep Reverend Dave Dow's family in your prayers, and all of those, Pastor Robert Lyons, in your prayer, a family in your prayers, and all of those that are grieving at this moment. Thank you so very much for being with us here on Truth for Transformation Thursday. Let's pray together. God, we love you and thank you for the jewels and nuggets that you've allowed us to see in your word. Now, God, give us the tenacity to understand that as long as we're focusing on you, that we made up in our minds that we're going to reach you, God, that whatever our situations might be, you are able to turn it around. And so, God, we pray for everybody who needs a turnaround right now, that they will get close enough to you to touch the hem of your garment. Everybody who has, God, somebody that they know, that they love, that they care about, that stands in the need of a blessing, that they will make their way to you, God, that you might in turn hear their request and heal their child. In the name of Jesus, keep us safe until we meet again. Have a marvelous day. Amen. And thank you for being with us. Have a wonderful night.